That's got to untangle this bit of modern technology. Well, it must have been wonderful to be at that seashore, mustn't it? And see all those fish being gathered in. Oh, don't worry about it, we'll get there in a minute. There we are. I must confess, I'm not a great lover of fish. Whenever I fet it, it swims around in my stomach. But nevertheless, I know most people do love fish. And they love fish and chips, and I welcome them well. But when my wife has fish, I have a steak pie. I'd like to thank Paul for helping in leading the meeting this morning, and for Liz for that exhilarating children's talk that we'll all remember, I'm sure. Now, I want to draw your attention this morning to that great statement that Job makes. In the 25th verse of Job 19, that great statement, I know that my Redeemer lives. It is a sure and certain statement. It is an amazing statement of confidence. It is an amazing statement that came in Job's darkest hour. Now we live today in an uncertain world, never quite knowing what tomorrow will bring. What is Russia going to do now that it's invaded the Ukraine? Will it invade Moldova, as some people fear? We have uncertain lives. Who knows when poor health will take us over? Job security is so uncertain. And yet, when we look to the Word of God, we have absolute certainties. The Bible is full of it. And time again, we read in the Word of God wonderful truths, amazing life-transforming truths. And the great certainty also is of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our great Creator, the great God of heaven and earth, wants us to leave us in no doubt about it. And according to Luke in Acts chapter 1, he's given many infallible proofs. He wants to give man a sure and certain hope in an uncertain world. The first century world was so uncertain. In AD 70, there was the siege of Jerusalem. There was a terrible persecution of God's people under Nero. And so it goes on and goes on. An uncertain world. But how thankful we are that when we look to the Bible, we can look at true certainties. For God does not deal with possibilities. Let all other religions deal with possibilities. Let the Watchtower religion deal with possibilities. It may be possible that you might be resurrected into the millennium. And then if you do your best throughout 1,000 years, you might eventually have everlasting life. Here are possibilities. But no, the Word of God deals with certainties. And here is this man, Job. And he is making this remarkable statement. And he's actually saying more than he really knows. And for those of us living in this present day, for those of us living in 2022, every believer knows this as an absolute certainty. I know that my Redeemer lives. Now here's a man in the depth of the most awful trial. He has lost his health. How awful it must have been for him in the midst of that trial. Can you imagine poor Job? And at the very beginning of the book of Job, we read, in Job chapter 2 and verses 7 and 8, we read that then Job took a piece of broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. He had painful sores from the soles of his feet to the top of his head. He had lost his family. He had lost his wealth. He had lost everything, and he had even lost the sympathy of his own wife, who encouraged him to curse God and die. Imagine being Job in that situation. And Job goes through this trial, and he has these three so-called friends that were really his critics, who had the right doctrine, but the most terrible and the most painful application. And there is Elihu at the end of the account. And yet in the midst of it all, Job had a tremendous and a wonderful confidence. In Job chapter 13 and verses 5 and 6, he says this: "If only you would be altogether silent, for you that would be wisdom. Hear now my argument, listen to the plea of my lips." And in chapter 14 and verse 16, "You will call and I will answer you. You will long for the creature your hands have made. Surely then you will count my steps, but not keep track of my sin." Oh, how Job went through such terrible trials and tribulations. And then in verses 18 to 21 of Job 16, "Oh earth, do not cover my blood. Hear my cry, never to be laid at rest. Even now my witness is in heaven. My advocate is on high. My intercessor is my friend. As my eyes pour out tears to God on behalf of a man who pleads with God as a man pleads for his friend." He also said, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him." But then there is this triumphant statement. There is this incredible, amazing statement. A shout of triumph. A shout of victory. A shout of faith. "I know that my Redeemer lives." How it must have sent a shiver down the spine of Satan. This one who had been permitted to cause all this trouble to fall upon Job. It was a great test for Job under the permissive will of God. And he states this absolutely. He states what he knows. We think of a redeemer in the days of Moses was the next of kin, whose duty it was to redeem a captive or an enslaved relative. We have that in Leviticus chapter 25 and verses 25 and 26. We have these remarkable and interesting words: "If one of your countrymen becomes poor and sells some of his property, his nearest relative is to come and redeem whatever his countryman has sold." To buy back, to purchase by his kinsman, by the goal. And Job looks for deliverance from his troubles. Job looks for vindication of his character. Job knows that ultimately there will be power delivered from the grave. And Job has complete confidence. "I know that my Redeemer lives." And this remarkable statement is fulfilled perfectly in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. We look back to the glorious resurrection, and we look with Job at this ultimate hope. For we live in a dying world. Friends and relatives are removed by death. But we have a next of kin. We have our elder brother. We have the glorious person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the resurrection is the most proven event in history. And God has given us a cast iron proof that has stood the test of the last 2,000 years, that the Lord Jesus is alive. Under the old covenant, if a person was sold into slavery, the goal was to pay his ransom. If he had mortgaged his inheritance, the goal was to pay it back. If he had sold himself into slavery, the Redeemer was to pay his ransom. If he was murdered, that one was to come and avenge his blood. And the Lord Jesus has come, and he's taken our nature without sin. He has purchased our happiness at Calvary. He has brought about the liberty of his people. He has avenged our blood on Satan, the god of this world. And the Lord Jesus has come and delivered us from slavery to sonship. And he is alive. And he is alive forevermore. And he's seated on the right hand of the Majesty on high. And every single Christian person is spiritually alive with him. He's seated with Christ in heavenly places. And we are brought near by his blood. We are reconciled to the Father by his death. We are led into this remarkable knowledge of this thing by the wonderful person of the Holy Spirit. Once we were strangers, and it was like a foreign language to us, and now we know the truth. He will redeem us from death. He will be glorified when he comes again on the clouds of heaven. And the believer can say, I know him from his word. I know him from his teaching. I know him as the object of my trust, and he alone is my confidence and my desire. I know him as my Redeemer, the one who purchased me with his own blood on the tree. He has rescued me from Satan. He has rescued me from my old way of life and the present evil world. And I know he lives, and because he lives, I shall live also. His resurrection is the guarantee of the believer's resurrection. Back about 1950, there was a young man in Tolworth, Surrey. And he was a rebellious young man. A scout hut was burned down next door to a gospel hall. And he was the prime suspect. Well, that young man was wonderfully saved, came to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus. And he went back to a totally non-Christian and anti-Christian home. And his mum and dad would constantly try and argue against the Christian faith. And he would say to them time and time again, Mum, Dad, with all your arguments, I know that my Redeemer lives. He became a Sunday school teacher at a young age of just 18. And when he was 19 years of age, he went on a Sunday school teachers conference at Climping near Littlehampton in Sussex. It was to cycle the 45 miles from Tolworth in Surrey. He would avoid his mother in the street because of her terrible language. And going down on that cycle trip to Climping in Littlehampton, he was tragically killed on the roads. A funeral took place at that gospel hall, Pine Road Gospel Hall in Surrey. His mother went in looking very grieved. How would you have felt? And she was saved there that day. And she came out a totally different person. And a short while later, his sister was saved. And his sister took a young lad called Ray Birch to the Sunday school. Because God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. And this text is inscribed on his tombstone in Surbiton in Surrey. I know that my Redeemer lives. Buddha and Mohammed are dead. The Lord Jesus is alive forevermore. And because he is alive forevermore, he has all authority in heaven and in earth. And he is alive and at work in this world. And as this world falls apart, he is alive working in the Ukraine. He is building his church. He is working in places where there is severe opposition. He is working in North Korea today. He is working in Pakistan and parts of Nigeria today. But as the old chorus puts it so well, you ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. Now, isn't that a remarkable statement? Christ in you, the hope of glory. That your Redeemer is living by his Spirit in every one of his believing people here this morning. He is my great high priest. And because of that, we don't need to go to any confessional. He is always there. He's always available. He's always ready to hear us. And when he was here, he said, I have power to lay it down with regard to his life, and I have power to take it again. No one could ever say that. No founder of any other world religion has been able to say that. But our Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore we can come with great confidence to this glorious Saviour and say, I know that my Redeemer lives. And when we come to die, and when we come to leave this world, as we all will, unless the Lord Jesus comes again in our lifetime, the believer can say on his deathbed, I know that my Redeemer lives. If you come here this morning with trials and tribulations and difficulties and perplexities and you don't know what the day is going to bring tomorrow, one thing you do know, if you are a true believer, that your Redeemer lives. And not only that he lives, but he's with you now. Whatever their trials are, he's with the dear believers in Ukraine. He's with the dear believers in the labor camps of North Korea. We thank God that he's with all of his believing people. And he will not break the bruised reed, and he will not quench the smoking flax. And one day every believer will see him with a resurrected eye. One day, every believer will see him as he is, and they will be like him. You see, when a person dies, their soul is immediately taken to heaven's glory, as it happened to my cousin those many years ago. And that is the intermediate state. And then when the Lord Jesus comes again, there will be the resurrection of the body. And the soul will be joined to the resurrected body. And what a confidence we have with this man Job. I know that my Redeemer lives. And that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh, that I might see God, I will see God. Can you say that this morning? Yes. Can you say that here this morning, honestly and openly? Is that your confidence? Job said this personally. I know. Can you say this personally? I know that my Redeemer lives. This is the one thing that matters to all true believers. I know that my Redeemer lives. And my prayer is that you may know it too. That in this so uncertain world, that you might know this wonderful, amazing, and glorious truth, that your Redeemer is alive and alive forevermore. He's freely available to everyone and anyone. And when you're called upon to go through times of tribulation and perplexity, the glorious truth is that the believer can say, I know that my Redeemer lives. You remember how the Lord Jesus spoke to Martha before the glorious resurrection of Lazarus. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Then he said to her, and I will say this to you this morning, do you believe this? What did she reply? Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. Do you believe this? Are you able to say, yes, I believe that you are the Son of God, and I know that my Redeemer lives. Whatever happens to me in this world, I know that one day I shall see him, and I shall see him with the eye of sight, and now I see him with the eye of faith. One day I shall see him as he is. You think of the people in the Ukraine. Many of them have lost everything. Many of them have lost their health. Some of them, like Job, have lost their families. 60 days ago, things were going normally in that land. And overnight, there was that dreadful invasion. I heard a man, Philip Swan, pray for Putin. Lord, either save him or smite him. And these people have nothing. Some of them have nothing. But may they be able to say, in spite of it all, I know that my Redeemer lives. You see, the believer can say, when push comes to shove, my Saviour has my treasure, and I will walk with him. Because the believer has a Redeemer. He has the unsearchable riches of Christ. He has him with them and for them. And he knows that this Redeemer loves them. And because he loves them, they are the Father's delight. And they are the most privileged people this world could ever know. If, like this cousin of mine, you were to die today, when you set out that day from Surbiton in Surrey to go down to Climping near Littlehampton, he had no idea what would happen. Where would you be? Then come to this Redeemer, the one who purchased sin on Calvary, the one who shed his blood, the one who took away the sin of the world, The one who came to seek the lost and to open the blind, to unstop the dead ears. The one who came to raise the dead. Will you not come now? Will you not come today? Will you not come this morning? Will you not come at this very moment and close with Jesus Christ? And it will be the greatest day of your life. Whatever you have done, there is a free and full forgiveness in Christ. Whoever you are, you may say, I've done the most terrible and despicable things. Even then, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Will you not come today? I urge you, I plead with you, come to know this glorious Redeemer, the wonderful Redeemer, the great purchaser of sinners. Your eternal destiny is at stake. And my prayer will be this, that one day I shall see every one of you in heaven's glory. Not one will be lost. I know that my Redeemer lives. May everyone here this morning be able to say that remarkable, confident, and assured statement. Let us pray. Glorious God, we know that for believers, when push comes to shove, the bottom line is, I know that my Redeemer lives. And we bless you for that, Lord. We thank you for it. We pray, Lord, for people in Ukraine. That may keep them going. And that, Lord, that they might know the presence of that dear Redeemer day by day in all the uncertainties. We pray for those connected with our fellowship who are going through a great trial. May they be able to say, I know that my Redeemer lives. We thank you for the encouraging statement that even in his darkest hour, with limited amount of revelation, limited amount of understanding, Job could say that with great shout of triumph. I know that my Redeemer lives. Oh God, may we ever be looking to this dear Redeemer. For Jesus' sake, amen. Amen.